Hello everyone. Today's gospel is divided into two parts. The first part involves Jesus' warning about scribes. During the time of Jesus, the scribes were considered influential Jewish religious leaders and experts in the Old Testament law. Presumably, some scribes were Pharisees. In the Gospels, they are mentioned most often among the groups of people usually in conflict with Jesus. However, not all the scribes were hostile toward Jesus. Indeed, some seemed to be among his admirers. For instance, you may recall that last week we read about a scribe who, with genuine admiration, acknowledged Jesus' response to his question regarding the greatest commandment and even further added that to love God with all of one's heart, understanding, strength, and to love one's neighbor as oneself is worth more than all burnt offerings and sacrifices. And Jesus commended the man by saying that he was not far from the kingdom of God. But today's gospel directs us to Jesus' warning to his listeners against the scribes' attitude and conduct. Indeed, there are many instances in the Gospels where Jesus gave the crowd warnings. This time he said, "Beware of the scribes who like to go around in long robes and accept greetings in the marketplaces, seats of honor in synagogues and places of honor at banquets. They devour the houses of widows and as a pretext recite lengthy prayers." Friends, Jesus' warning contained two serious charges against the scribes. The primary charge against the scribes was that they were dressing in a way that drew attention to themselves. Friends, in the time of Jesus, in Palestine and the surrounding regions, the kings, priests, and people of rank and prominence used to wear long robes made of rich materials, whereas common people wore tunics. In obedience to the instruction from the book of Numbers, the Israelites used to make tassels on the corners of their garments in order to identify themselves as Jews and that they were people of God. The scribes, probably either in imitation of the priests, wore long robes or wore tunics with the extra long tassels to distinguish themselves from others and to be associated with the prestigious temple establishment. Now, there was nothing wrong in wearing long robes or wearing outsized tassels on the robes. Nonetheless, some scribes were fond of wearing these robes in public, whenever they visited the temples and synagogues, marketplaces and special events, so as to attract notice, greetings and places of honor. Friends, the second charge was that they were exploiting the people, particularly widows, in violation of the covenantal commandments. Friends, in Jesus' time, since the scribes acted both as teachers and interpreters of the law, many people had them involved both in their spiritual and legal matters, which was to pray for them and, as needed, to manage their money. They were forbidden to ask for payment for their services. However, nothing prohibited them from soliciting contributions for their personal support. They also used to make long prayers to make themselves look good and dear to God. Their false piety made it easy for them to take advantage of vulnerable people in Jewish society, such as widows. Indeed, their actions were tantamount to coveting and stealing the widow's livelihood on behalf of the temple. Thus, Jesus warned the crowd to guard against the ostentatiousness, covetousness, rapacity, hypocrisy, and capricious conduct of the scribes. And at the same time, Jesus said to them that those scribes who exploited the people under the guise of religious commitment would face severe condemnation. Friends, here Jesus did not say what kind of punishment would be meted out. But in another context, Jesus said, "To whomever much is given, of him will much be required, and to whom much is entrusted, of him more will be asked. Friends, the second part of the gospel concerns people's offerings to God. As Jesus was sitting in the temple near the offering box and watching people put in their offerings, he noticed some rich people dropping large sums of money, probably putting them in the metal boxes in such a way that the crowd could hear the clinking sound. Friends, in Jesus' day, the coins were minted in precious metal, and the value of the coin was known by the weight and size. And so, when people dropped the coins made of different metals and sizes, people could calculate from the clinking sound the value of the coins. Whereas the widow shyly dropped her two small coins into the box, they hardly made any sound. But despite the crowded, noisy temple courtyard, Jesus heard what no one else could. As the coins fell into the offering box, he heard two clinks, which drew attention to a sacrificial gift. Friends, the widow's contribution to the temple treasury were not worth much, but presumably represented a significant portion of her daily wage. It was too small to sustain her for long, but probably was large enough to afford a meal. Friends, by her giving, she did not just fulfill her religious duty, but rather humbly and gratefully acknowledged God as the source of all she needed. And Jesus recognized the widow's gift and said to his disciples that her contribution was greater than others, because while the others had given from their surplus and thus did not sacrifice anything much to God, she, despite her need, gave all she had to live on. Friends, here Jesus had based his calculation not on what the widow gave, but on what she had left for herself. Friends, what is the message for us? 1. I believe that the first part of the gospel is wholly applicable to all who hold formal and informal positions and authority in our church, including the elders, deacons, priests, bishops, preachers, pastors, nuns, ministers, and the Pope. Friends, just like in the days of Jesus, we do either witness or experience the abuse or misuse of a position and of authority by some of our church leaders. Sadly, some are more concerned with personal comfort, privilege, and gain than with faithful service. Their attitude, behavior, and lifestyles cause discomfort and scandals to our faith and community. Friends, today we shall pray for such leaders that they may take heed of Jesus' warning to the scribes to avoid the Lord's severe condemnation. We shall pray that they may repent for the glory of God. At the same time, we must recognize that there are also thousands of very sincere, dedicated, God-centered, and compassionate leaders inside the church. They willingly sacrifice their time, energy, families, friends, home, riches, and emotional needs, even their very lives if need be, to advance the kingdom of God on this earth. They sincerely attend to the spiritual needs of people and tirelessly work for the upliftment of the poor, the helpless, and the vulnerable. Friends, today we shall pray for those leaders as well, by name, when we can, every day and at every Mass. 2. Friends, each of us can be tempted to abuse the stewardship entrusted to us over the lives of vulnerable people. We can be tempted to treat badly those people who work under us and those who are in our care for our own personal gain. However, it is not necessary to be rich or powerful to exploit vulnerable people, and it is not only people at the bottom who are vulnerable. Sometimes, weaker individuals under certain circumstances can be tempted to victimize someone with power. For instance, a person can be tempted to falsely accuse a supervisor of discrimination or sexual harassment. In those situations, the employer or supervisor can be vulnerable. just as a poor person is vulnerable. Friends, it is possible for nearly any of us to injure vulnerable people. Of those who do so, Jesus warns that they would receive a severe condemnation. 3. The second part of the Gospel teaches us that while no one else might see or notice what we do for others, God sees everything, even the smallest acts of generosity and faith. He can see our motives or why we act. Moreover, when we give something out of our abundance, it may not hurt. But when we give out of our nothingness, as the poor widow did, it will really hurt. Friends, during those times, let us recall the following words of St. Mother Teresa of Calcutta and St. Paul. Teresa said, "The true meaning of love is to give until it hurts." Paul said, "Each of you must give as you have made up your mind, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver." 4. Friends, St. Paul made tents for a living, to provide for his needs while he traveled and taught in the churches. When writing to a group of elders in Ephesus, Paul told them that he had not been paid with gold and silver or even with clothing, but had provided for his own needs as well as those who traveled with him. And he further instructed them to follow his own example in that regard, for it is more blessed to give than to receive. Friends, even though this instruction is meant to encourage the church leaders to give sacrificially from their own income to help the poor and needy in the church, as well as those who partner with them in the ministry, it also encourages us, as the faithful, to readily and joyfully give to the church for its needs. 5. Lastly, friends, I would like to take this opportunity to thank you all, here in Hong Kong and my friends around the world, for your dedication and help to our church, St. Peter's, and our ministry for seafarers, the Apostleship of the Sea, over the past 50 years, especially for your pledged support to our present needs. Friends, let us continue to support the mission of the church and do kind acts of charity and good works in the name of Jesus and for the glory of God. Amen. God bless you.